Hey, what is up, everybody? Now, I know it's very rare I come on here and just kind of give you guys like a wrestling talk video where I just come on here and shoot about different topics of wrestling. But I figured I would do it this time just because of the fact that there's been so much stuff that's been going on in the world of professional wrestling lately. You know, obviously it is WrestleMania time, but there's been a lot of just talks about what's going on with wrestling that I've been reading articles and stuff all week, so I kind of want to just come on here and just kind of read through each of these articles and just kind of get my thoughts on them, whether I think they're true or not, and whether some of them is true because it's off the website. So, and just kind of talk about what I think about these certain topics. And I just want to make sure you guys know that I will not be talking about anything that pertains to what happened with Raw, SmackDown, 205 Live, or NXT this week. I already did those videos. I will plug them, though. The What's Better, Raw or SmackDown series you can find right over here. That's on my CM Brothers channel, which you can also give a subscribe to afterwards. WWE 205 Live you can find over here for the review for this week. Or you can also just, click on my channel and just find it itself, and then down here you will find my WWE NXT review for this week. So now that I've kind of gotten that stuff out of the way, let me talk about the stuff that I feel like is worth addressing. Alright, so the first article I want to read is called Vince McMahon Involved in Automobile Accident. And this article came out on March 21st, 2017. So let me read it. It hasn't been the best day to be the chairman of the board. Vince McMahon and WWE have had a pretty bad week, to say the least. They've had scandals on top of scandals, and all the while they were preparing for their biggest show of the year in Orlando in 12 days, which, since this article sounds a little dated because it came out on March 21st, so that's why I'm reading this. Now, Vince McMahon has to worry about calling his insurance company because Vinnie Mac was involved in a minor traffic accident around the WWE headquarters today. Although there are no injuries being reported, his Bentley didn't get off so lucky. McMahon was driving in his Black Beauty when something went wrong. It's unclear exactly what happened, but another car was involved in the accident. TMZ reports that the incident is being described as a minor traffic accident. But when you're talking about Vince, nothing is a minor incident. Rubberneckers caught a glimpse in photos of Vince walking around the scene of the accident, which happened about a mile away from Titan Towers, as proof. You can see Vince walking around in the pictures below, and by the looks of things, he doesn't look too pissed to be on foot. So yeah, that's Vince McMahon walking around on foot. And then we have a tweet from Casey Michael that says, "Poor Vince," and it was tweeted on March 21st, 2017 at 1:00 p.m. You can easily find his Twitter though by looking up @boycasey. I think is how you look it up. In all honesty, things could have been much worse, and we're glad everything is okay. Accidents happen, but when you're Vince McMahon, things tend to escalate. Whether or not it will be deemed Vince's fault is unclear, but regardless of what the insurance company's rule on the matter, we're guessing we'll be able to pay. He'll be able to pay whatever damages he's owed from the pretty cash he probably keeps up in his glove compartment. And that's it. To give my thoughts on this, I'm glad nobody was hurt in this situation. You know, everybody will always trash Vince McMahon, and you know, everybody will always hate on Vince McMahon for the stuff that he's done throughout the wrestling business. However, I don't want the guy to get hurt either. And, you know, I don't think the guy's all bad. He has some questionable things I have about him, but I think he's an okay, decent guy. And, you know, I'm glad to see that he didn't get hurt, and I'm glad to see that the other guy driving the car didn't get hurt either. And it's also nice to see, you know, I do hope that, you know, the situation that he's dealing with, well, he'll be able to pull through pretty okay. So, yeah, glad to see nobody was hurt. I hope that, you know, nothing, no charges or anything like that come up with Vince McMahon. The guy doesn't, like, try to sue or anything like that. Because this is Vince McMahon. He's a, you know, he runs a billion-dollar company. So, you know, I could say that guy, I hope that the guy doesn't try to cheap him out and try to get money out of him. And I hope that he can get out of this situation pretty good. But I feel like this, I heard everything's fine. I thought it was worth talking about, so. So now I want to move on to my next article. It's called WrestleMania Access Matches to Future Superstars from NXT, 205 Live, the UK Championship Tournament, Progress and Insane Championship Wrestling. And this is off the WWE's website. So let me read it. I know I'm not going to be going to WrestleMania Access, but I figured I'd read it for those that are curious. Live in-ring action is an annual tradition of WrestleMania Access, but this year's fan celebration features an even more excited and diverse talent lineup than ever. For the first time in history, superstars from not only NXT, but also WWE 205 Live, the UK Championship Tournament, Progress Wrestling, and Insane Championship Wrestling, or ICW for short, will compete at Access. WWE 205 Live is home to the RIN's top cruiserweights and the groundbreaking, critically acclaimed UK Championship Tournament held over the course of two nights in January. Shine a light of the United Kingdom's toughest competitors, London-based Progress Wrestling and Glasgow, Scotland-based ICW, meanwhile, represent the first non-WWE promotions to have their competitors be featured at Access. Because, you know, this was done by Triple H. He wanted to work out some deals with some of these smaller companies, and I guess he's done just that. Check out the match lineup below, and don't wait to secure your spot at Access. This year's WrestleMania Access runs Thursday, March 30th to Sunday, April 2nd at the Orange County Convention Center in Orlando, Florida. Tickets are all available now at Ticketmaster.com. I will not be going to Access since I'm not going to WrestleMania, but I still will read the matches. So these are the matches for Thursday, March 30th. Matches featuring superstars from 205 Live, including Rich Swann versus The Brian Kendrick. That should be a good matchup right there. They've always had good matches, you know, from when 205 Live first started. And I think they'll have a fantastic match. TJ Perkins versus Drew Gulak should be another good matchup right there. They're both really pretty good wrestlers. Plus, returning NXT superstar Hideo Itami and many others will be in action. Because recently Hideo Itami came back. I'm happy he's back. I'm hoping he can stay healthy. So I'm pretty happy to see Hideo Itami back. Then we have Friday, March 31st, matches featuring superstars from the UK Championship Tournament, Progress Wrestling, and ICW, including WWE United Kingdom Champion Tyler Bate versus Mark Hackins in a United Kingdom Championship match, Progress Wrestling Champion Pete Dunne versus Mark Andrews. But the Tyler Bate, Mark Hackins match, Haskins match, I think could be pretty good. Pete Dunne, Mark Andrews will have a clinic. They've always had fantastic matches. The two matches I've seen them have together have been really good. Plus, Progress and ICW superstars such as Jimmy Havoc, TK Cooper, Travis Banks, Dahlia Black, Tony Storm, and Ginny will compete in a WWE ring for the first time. I don't really know a lot of these wrestlers because I don't watch Progress Wrestling, but, you know, good treat for the fans. Next one is on Saturday, April 1st, and it's the 8 a.m. session. It's matches featuring superstars from 205 Live, the UK Championship Tournament, and Progress Wrestling, including Akira Tozawa versus Aria Davari, which should be a pretty good matchup. Progress Champion Pete Dunne versus Wolfgang should be a pretty good matchup. I enjoy Wolfgang's matches, and Pete Dunne really has really good matches. And WWE United Kingdom Champion Tyler Bate versus Joseph Connors in a United Kingdom Championship match. Joseph Connors, I remember really liking in the UK Championship Tournament. And then Tyler Bate's obviously another good wrestler, so I can't wait. So that should be a really good matchup right there. And many other belts. Then we have the same day, the 1 p.m. session. It's matches featuring NXT superstars and former NXT superstars, including Heavy Machinery versus the Vaudevillains. Heavy Machinery are a pretty good team, and the Vaudevillains are another great team that don't get used that much, so that should be good. Tino Stampatelli and Riddick Moss versus The Ascension. Don't know how that match could be, but since The Ascension are in it, it could be bad. Plus, matches featuring Liv Morgan, Dario Baronato, and more superstars. So, the 1 p.m. session doesn't look all that great, but it looks all right. Then we have the same day. It's the 6 p.m. session. It's matches featuring superstars from NXT, 205 Live, and the United Kingdom Championship Tournament, including Akira Tozawa versus Steve Cutler. I like Akira Tozawa. He's really good. Steve Cutler's okay, so that match shouldn't be that bad. ICW Heavyweight Champion Trent Seven versus Noam Dar. That should be a pretty good matchup right there. Noam Dar, I think, is a good wrestler, and I really like Trent Seven. And then we have a tag team match. TJ Perkins and Mustafa Ali versus Tino Cipitelli and Riddick Moss. That match should be pretty good. And then the last one is from Sunday, April 2nd. It's matches featuring superstars from the UK Championship Tournament, Progress Wrestling, and ICW, including ICW Heavyweight Champion Trent Seven versus Wolfgang. That match should be pretty good. They had a really good match in the United Kingdom Championship Tournament. So, WWE United Kingdom Champion Tyler Bate versus Pete Dunne in a UK Championship match. That match should be really good. You know, they had a really good finals for the title, so that match should be really good. I thought that match would have happened at NXT TakeOver Orlando, but I guess it's not happening. Plus, Progress and ICW superstars such as Mark Haskins, Jimmy Havoc, TK Cooper, Travis Banks, Dalia Black, Tino Storm, and Ginny. Talent listed and depicted as above is subject to change, though. But if these matches all do happen, they should be really good. Some of these matches will they should be at least good to, like, really good. So that should be some good, interesting stuff. The people that are going to see this stuff are really lucky, so enjoy. These sound like good matches right here. And then the next thing is, this next article that I'm going to read is called WWE Officials Reportedly Hold Backstage Meeting to Discuss the Page Leak. Everybody knows, I've talked about it already on this channel, but, it's going to talk about it in this article, so I'll just say it real quick. It's been a rough week for Paige, Xavier Woods, and Brad Maddox, and a few other wrestling stars as well. Last week, Paige was targeted in a hacking scandal, and several private photos and videos leaked onto the internet. The leak has been a very hot topic as of late, but WWE officials are keeping it quiet in regards to the explicit photos and videos, and they have yet to address the situation publicly or issue a statement. I talked about the situation earlier this week, and this is a pretty, you know, hectic situation. I've been making a lot of jokes about it. I've been talking about it in a serious light. Something that's really hard is it's hard for me to look at Xavier Woods the same now. Like, I just can't look at him the same. Brad Maddox, I especially can't look at the same. So, but continuing. Even though I kind of already wasn't looking at Paige the same, now I kind of extremely can't look at Paige the same. But the continuing is PW Insider reports that WWE officials held a backstage meeting at the Barclays Center in Brooklyn to discuss the leaks before Raw on Monday. Triple H and Vince McMahon were reportedly present, but it's not known exactly what was discussed. There's a lot of talk about whether or not Paige or Xavier Woods will be punished because of the leaks, And Dave Meltzer recently noted on Westland Observer Radio that company officials don't plan to punish them. Which I've talked about, they shouldn't get punished. You know, this was something that was out of control. It wasn't their fault these photos got leaked. At least for Xavier Woods' case. For somewhat Paige's case, one thing that she should get punished for is disgracing the NXT Women's Championship, because she pretty much did sexual things with that, and that's a company championship, and, you know, you kind of have to have more, you kind of have to have more respect for the company's title, because a lot of women worked up the ranks to get that title, and the fact that she did that kind of pisses me off. That's something that Paige should be punished for. And that's how I feel. WWE officials are waiting for the situation to blow over. However, it was noted that they could take some sort of action if sponsors start to complain. Although WWE has kept quiet in regards to the leak, there was quite a few fans in Brooklyn chanting "We want Paige" on Monday. For now, it seems that the company policy is just to ignore the noise, so we'll have to wait and see if all the chants die down anytime soon. And that's it. So, this is a very weird situation. I talked about this before. But I think that's probably the best thing to do, is just to let it die down. It's going to be tough to get to quiet the fans during WrestleMania, because it's WrestleMania week and the new day of the host of WrestleMania. So when Xavier Woods comes out, he's going to get chanted. You know, it's going to be some backlash, so we're going to have to wait and see what happens there. But yeah, I pretty much have given my thoughts about this whole situation. Another thing, though, that I want to say is obviously Paige's parents aren't really are kind of making this situation forgettable. Like, Paige is kind of trying to shake it off, but her parents are being really protective of her. Being a little bit over dramatic about it, because they're still talking about it. And the advice I want to give to Paige's parents is to stop talking about it, because the more you talk about it, the more the situation's going to stay. If you just ignore it, let it go, then the situation's going to be forgotten about. I mean, I talked about this before. It was just like when Seth Rollins' photo got leaked. Eventually, people started talking about it. It was this big thing, but eventually people forgot about it. I myself somewhat forgot about it, and, you know, look what happened. He at WrestleMania 31, he walked out as the WWE World Heavyweight Champion. So, but the difference is here, I guess you could say, is that Seth Rollins was in a better state with the company than Paige is at the moment. So, but we're going to have to wait and see what happens. All right. Next article is called Triple H on Why the Rock Always Returns to WWE. And then on Raw viewership being down this week. This will be the only Raw coverage I guess I'll cover. The Rock is one of the most popular WWE superstars of all time. But now he's on a whole different level. The Rock was named the highest paid actor in the world in 2016. And it's safe to say that he has successfully conquered Hollywood. Triple H recently appeared on ESPN First Take, and he was asked how he stops Hollywood from poaching talent from the WWE. He said the short answer is, you don't. Triple H also talked about what makes WWE different from Hollywood, and why a big star like The Rock constantly feels the urge to return. So these are Triple H's words. You get nothing like you get with the WWE. When 100,000 fans are chanting your name and going crazy, there is nothing, I mean nothing, that gives you the adrenaline rush like that. It's why The Rock comes back. He's busy, trust me. He makes movies. He's making TV shows. His production company, 7 Bucks, is all over the place. He owns Hollywood pretty much. He still gravitates back to the WWE universe because of the fan base. Because of that connection you can't get anywhere else. It's versatile, it's palatable. It's just what we do. We create memories that when you go to something like WrestleMania, that memory lasts a lifetime. People forget what you say and what you do, but they remember how they make you feel. And it says Triple H also talked about acquiring international talent and more in the video below, so I'll probably give that a listen to. But, you know, what Triple H is saying is absolutely right. You know, when you go to a wrestling show, it's different. I mean, I can't say being in the ring, but I can say it's when you go to a wrestling show, it's different than going to, like, a concert. You know, going to, like, a football game. It's interactive. And, you know, The Rock, truly, you can feel like loves wrestling. He doesn't have to come back every year, but he wants to come back every year, you know. And WrestleMania is the year to come back, because when he comes back, WrestleMania time, that's when everybody is fully invested. So I like the fact that The Rock comes back, and The Rock loves being there, you know. I think he feels bad that he wasn't there for a few years because his relationship with Vince McMahon kind of went south for a while. So I think The Rock truly wants to be there. So I expect him to pop back up at WrestleMania next Sunday. So don't know what he's going to be doing, but we'll have to wait and see. And then this last article is, this week's episode of the WWE Monday Night Raw featured more hype for WrestleMania 33, and the show drew 3.048 million viewers, according to show Buzz Daily. Viewership was down this week compared to the 3.232 million viewers who watched last week's show. This week, the first hour of WWE Raw drew 3.163 million viewers, followed by the second hour, which drew 3.177 million viewers. The third and final hour drew 2.866 million viewers. And that's it. I mean, I've talked about this before, too, that, you know, Raw's ratings continue to decline. And this is pretty sad that it's happening this time of year due to the fact that it's WrestleMania season. And they can't keep people to watch the full 3 hours of Raw. It's pretty sad. And I don't know, what to say about that, actually. You know, they definitely need to change stuff up because, Raw just hasn't been very good. It's not written very well. It has the same format. You know, I've talked about this a handful of times. Push new stars. The fact that they have two part-timers fighting for the WWE Universal Championship, like Goldberg and Brock Lesnar. You know, they push guys like Roman Reigns instead of the guy that actually connected the universe, like Kevin Owens. I mean, I like Roman Reigns and all, but you get what they're forcing him down our throats. So there's a lot of things that has to do with that. Now, that I probably should have read this one earlier in the video, but whatever. It's DDP reveals what he would do to the Page attacker. Now, I'm not going to read the second part of the article because it's already happened and I really don't give a shit about it. So let's talk about it. It's been a big week for DDP because it was recently announced that Eric Bischoff will be the man to induct him into the WWE Hall of Fame, which is a huge thing. You know, it's going to be nice to see Eric Bischoff. He's technically been back in WWE. He's done things like the Monday Night War intros, and he's done the Legends with JBL show, so it's going to be nice to see him back, though, speaking at a WWE event. And I think he's the perfect person to put DDP in. It's been a big week for Paige as well, but unfortunately for all the wrong reasons. TMZ recently caught up with DDP, and they asked him about the Paige hacking scandal, and he wasn't shy about letting the world know what he wants to do to the hacker who leaked Paige's private photos. And this is his quote. "I like to bitch slap him in front of everybody. How's that? She's a sweetheart woman. I just want to go away because I just wanted to go away because she's a good lady. She's amazing. Women's wrestling right now is unbelievable. Charlotte Flair, I mean, if that ain't his daddy's daughter, she's unbelievable. Not just as an entertainer, as an athlete. There's nothing she can't do. I love all the girls, Sasha and Becky and Paige. I was really bummed out when she hurt her neck like that. Hopefully she'll be back. It is what it is, bro." You can see DDP get inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame on March 31st, and you can check out the video below. So I'll probably watch that video because I bet it's Pretty cool, but yeah, it's yeah, I've talked about it, but yeah, it's nice to see DDP, and I don't blame DDP for wanting to bitch slap that person. And then another article is called WWE Set to Win Back Classic Raw Exclusive Pay-Per-View. And here it is. Ever since the WWE draft took place in the summer of 2016, the original pay-per-view events that WWE presented as a sole brand have been split between both Raw and SmackDown. With SmackDown being given Elimination Chamber and Money in the Bank, which is stupid that Money in the Bank isn't a double-branded pay-per-view, but whatever. It seems that Raw needs to step up, which is why, according to Mick Johnson of PW Insider, we will be bringing back Bad Blood as a Raw exclusive pay-per-view event, which I'm pretty excited about. I always liked that pay-per-view, Bad Blood. But he continued. But the article continues by saying Bad Blood has only been presented by WWE 3 times before, in 1997, 2003, and 2004, all as part of the Raw, all as part of the Red brand, and it is the event where the Hell in a Cell match was first introduced and used as the main event of all 3 shows. According to the report, the event is set to return on July 9, 2017, at the XL Center in Hartford, Connecticut. So maybe I'll possibly go to it. This could be an important event for Raw in their build-up to SummerSlam, especially since SmackDown will be presenting Money in the Bank at around the same time, so the ratings war will be reaching its peak. Bad Blood was always one of the biggest grudge-ending events of its era, and it gave Raw the edge over SmackDown much of the time. If it is able to keep the same kind of aura around it, then this will be a fantastic nostalgic move by WWE. But if not, then this is just a waste of time. So hopefully that's what happens. But yeah, I'm pretty excited about Bad Blood coming back as a pay-per-view. Then these next 3 articles has to do with the whole Mo and Aleo being missing in action lately. So I'm just gonna kind of talk about this. So this one's called Mo and Aleo Missing Again from SmackDown. And this article, by the way, is a little dated. It was written on March 21st, 2017. For the second week in a row, Mo Amanalo is absent from the SmackDown broadcast table. The Blue brand's signature voice was notably absent from last week's broadcast after allegedly missing the shows due to a blizzard that affected his travel. Considering the weather, it seemed like a fairly common reason to miss work, but on a recent episode of Wrestling Observer Radio, Dave Meltzer said that there was more to Mo's absence than inclement weather, but wouldn't provide additional details. So, since this was, like I said, wait, it's a little dated, but tonight on SmackDown, Tom Phillips and JBL announced that Ranallo was missing again due to being out sick. Adding to the speculation, Ranallo has since gone completely silent on his social media, and no news has come out regarding what's going on with him. So that's what I thought was suspicious, that the fact that he's been quiet on Twitter. Former SmackDown announcer Taz also discussed the situation on his radio show. Taz also discussed the situation on his radio show. So this is a quote from Taz. "You cannot miss a show. You can't. You can't miss a show. When you miss a show in no order of preference, you get heat with the locker room. You get heat with your boss. You get heat with your broadcast colleagues. It's just not a regular job. You are there once a week and you are making a lot of money with a massive, massive platform. You've got to be there. You've got to make the shot, no matter what happens. Moore is from Canada, okay? So he's well-versed when it comes to weather and snow. People knew the snow was coming for days. You have to prepare yourself to get ready to get to that town early." Moro's current SmackDown. So yeah, that's Taz's words. I can understand, I guess, Taz's perspective, but I mean, you can't really control the snow. But then here's what. But then there's more. Moro's current SmackDown partner JBL responded to Taz post, tweeting, "Great video," and told Moro, "We could have talked about Taz's video, but you didn't show up for work. Everyone else did." That message was later deleted. I felt like what JBL said was kind of an asshole thing. Since joining WWE, the 47-year-old Ronaldo has become the best announcer in the business, putting his experience from calling mixed martial arts to give professional wrestling a much-needed sense of big fight realism. His enthusiasm on the mic is contagious, and younger fans appreciate his uncanny ability to slip hip-hop lyrics into the calling of his matches. Is Moro's time with WWE prematurely coming to an end? So I had the same question, you know, because it was weird that he hasn't been on the shows recently. But then there was an update. There was an update on March 23rd, 2017, yesterday. And it says, and this article is called Real Reason Moro Ronaldo Has Been Absent from SmackDown. WWE announced on this week's episode of SmackDown Live that Moro Ronaldo was absent from the broadcast because he was sick. They also announced the previous week that he was unable to make this show because of a snowstorm. So what exactly is going on with Ronaldo? Which is the same question I had. The Wrestling Observer newsletter indicated that the reason he has been off WWE television both weeks is because Ronaldo suffers from depression. This has been an ongoing issue with him dating back to his teenage years, and he has been vocal about his condition in his past interviews. So that is kind of sad, actually. It's actually kind of made me sad to think that Moro Ronaldo had these type of issues. While Ronaldo has not really been in a contact with most people, two of his closest friends have confirmed that he's okay and is resting up. This is not his first time he has missed events due to depression, as he's missed an Invicta MMA show for the reason. I know this article is a little sad to think that Moro Ronaldo went through something like this. It's kind of sad, you know. I think that Moro Ronaldo goes through these type of depression issues. But then there's more. Moro Ronaldo was noticeably absent. So this is another article that's called Moro Ronaldo Updates Fans on His Status. Moro Ronaldo was noticeably absent from this week's episode of SmackDown Live, and the lack of Moro on Tuesday night got a lot of people talking. It was later reported that Moro wasn't at the event because he's suffering from depression. The SmackDown Live commentator is usually very active on Twitter, but he's been quiet as of late. However, he recently used the social media site to thank fans for their support. And this is Moro Ronaldo on Twitter on March 23rd, 2017 at 11:45 p.m. And you can find his hashtag by looking at Moro Ronaldo. I'm deeply touched by your tweets of support. My doctor wants me to stay off social media for now, but I wanted to thank you. So yeah, it's not a great situation that he's in. It actually does kind of suck, and I kind of hope that I don't think JBL and Taz were personally trying to attack Moro. They probably didn't know what he was going through. So I hope that JBL and Taz apologize to Moro Ronaldo, because you know, they didn't really know the sincerity of his situation. I can maybe JBL I'm kind of a little bit pissed at, because JBL should know that he goes through this type of stuff. He works with the guy every week, so I'm a little bit pissed about JBL without that. But Taz, I can completely understand, because he's never worked with Moro Ronaldo, so you know. But I think WWE didn't want to say these reasons because of Moro Ronaldo, because they wanted to, you know, they didn't want to give away his personal life. So these were just storyline reasons why he wasn't there. I don't know what's going to happen with Moro Ronaldo, if he's going to make WrestleMania or not. So, but it is kind of funny how this happens. Well, not funny, but you get what I'm saying. And then the next part of this article is called Bayley Wants to Wrestle Stephanie McMahon. I know, right? Crazy. Bayley is set to make her WrestleMania debut this year, and she'll be doing it as the Raw Women's Champion. She's going to be defending her title against Sasha Banks, Nia Jax, and Charlotte in a Fatal 4-Way match on WrestleMania Sunday. Everybody knows how I feel about that Fatal 4-Way match. This is hopefully only the beginning of Bayley's WrestleMania career because she's got a big dream match in mind. The current WWE Raw Women's Champion recently spoke to NBC Sports and she revealed that she wants to face Stephanie McMahon. And then this is what she said. I've thought about that so many times, even when I was a kid. And then she laughs. When she was having matches with Lita, I was like, I want to have matches with Stephanie one day. That's one of my dream matches, to be honest. If I could continue on, like you said, with Austin and Vince, that would be so much fun. But I am sure it's a little much to ask right now. Then it asks, who would you be rooting for if Bayley faced Stephanie McMahon at WrestleMania? Sounds off in the comments below. I personally wouldn't mind seeing a Bayley-Stephanie McMahon match. It's a match that actually makes sense. You know, you have Bayley, Stephanie McMahon, that's that authority figure that always puts people down. Bayley is that perfect person. And one of the problems about Stephanie McMahon's character on TV is that none of the male wrestlers can put their hands on her. So that would be pretty interesting. So yeah, I do want to see Bayley, Stephanie McMahon, and I would like to see Bayley get a huge victory over Stephanie McMahon. Hell, if you don't want to do that match at WrestleMania, do that match at maybe like a SummerSlam or something. I think that would be pretty interesting. So then this is huge news that I'm actually pretty damn excited about. The latest on the Hardy sign-ins, a new WWE deal, and WWE interested in Senior Benjamin. So this is like huge. And I'm getting this off of the same website. Ever since the Hardys introduced the Broken Universe to the world last year, fans have been calling for Broken Matt and Brother Nero to return to WWE. At this point, it remains to be seen if the brothers will be able to take the Broken Universe anywhere because Impact Wrestling is currently claiming that they're rightful owners of the intellectual property, which is complete bullcrap, because then it says the next is, however, Matt Hardy has made it very clear that he won't be giving up the gimmick without a fight. Because the whole thing is, I'll just kind of state that TNA Impact Wrestling claims that they own the gimmick because Matt Hardy used the broken gimmick in TNA first, but Matt Hardy has gone on record saying that he completely came up with this gimmick, and I personally believe them mainly because, one, it's TNA. I totally don't believe that TNA would come up with this genius of a gimmick. I just don't. And two, because of the stuff that they say, Matt Hardy has complete control. And I find like this is kind of weird now because now that they're not in the fold, you know, Matt Hardy has used this gimmick in other places. He's used it in Ring of Honor. He's used it in Top World Promotions. He's used it in other What Culture Pro Wrestling. He's used it, you know, all over the world. What the hell is going on? Why is it all of a sudden now a problem? Is it because he's possibly going to be taking this gimmick to WWE? So yeah. But then again, it says, regardless of what gimmick they use going forward, the Hardys have plenty of options and regardless to their future. It was recently reported that they've been offered WWE contracts, and now that everyone's waiting to find out if they will put pen to paper and return to the company that made them stars. Because I personally want to see them go back to WWE. PW Insider was reporting that the return of WWE isn't a matter of if, but a matter of when at this point. House Hardy member... That's pretty encouraging news because, you know, I really want to see the Hardy Boys come back to WWE. This is where, like I said, this is their home. You know, they can go to any other wrestling companies, but WWE is their home. So, I hope that happens. House Hardy members Senior Benjamin, Queen Rebecca, and Ken Maxwell have become quite popular in their own right. But it's reported that the WWE deal on the table is only being offered to Matt and Jeff at this time. That doesn't necessarily... So, I can understand, though, because Senior Benjamin, Queen Rebecca, and Ken Maxwell have had their share in this gimmick, so it'd be interesting. But then it says this. That doesn't necessarily mean that the characters such as Senior Benjamin couldn't be used in WWE in the future, but they have not been offered deals. I think, let me continue reading, then I'll give my thoughts on this. A big issue that will have to be worked out in regards to the deal is scheduling. At this point, it doesn't seem likely that Matt or Jeff Hardy would be willing or able to work a full-time WWE schedule, so the two parties would obviously have to agree on the terms. Then it continues talking about saying that Jeff Hardy let the cat out of the bag recently when he confirmed that their contract with Ring of Honor is only a short-term deal. It's believed that the deal will likely end after the Supercard of Honor show on April 1st. If that is the case, it would leave the Hardys open for an appearance at WrestleMania on April 2nd. It has already been confirmed that the Hardys will be in Orlando on WrestleMania Sunday for the Broken Hardy tailgate party. However, that does not necessarily mean they'll be appearing at WrestleMania, but if the ROH deal truly does end on April 1st, it simply means that they would be available to make an appearance if WWE officials choose to bring them in. So, yeah, I would like to see Senior Benjamin, Queen Rebecca, and Ken Maxwell come into the company as well. And here's why. Just because of the fact that they're a part of this Broken Hardy gimmick too. But I don't want them to all come in at once, because I think, you know, you could bring them in at a series at a time. When it comes down to it, though, yeah, the Hardys maybe probably won't work a full schedule because you have Jeff Hardy who has a lot of injuries and stuff. So that part you'd have to work through. Maybe you can have him, like, work going into, like, until SummerSlam, and then they can take a break, come back at the Royal Rumble, or come back at Survivor Series or something. But if they show up at WrestleMania, that would be huge. That would be awesome if they showed up at WrestleMania. And I hope they can use the gimmick that they have. I personally would like to see the Hardy Boys come back either way, whether it's with this gimmick, whether it's just as the Matt and Jeff Team Extreme. It will personally doesn't matter to me, but I think but under this gimmick would be really cool because they've done it all over the world. It'd be really cool to see them do it in WWE until WWE found a way to mess it up. But we'll have to wait and see. And then the next article is called, Here's Why the WWE Hall of Fame Invitation Makes Jim Cornette Angry. This year's WWE Hall of Fame class currently consists of Kurt Angle, Diamond Dallas Page, Beth Phoenix, Teddy Long, Rick Rude, and the Rock and Roll Express. Fans were shocked when it was recently announced that Jim Cornette will induct the Rock and Roll Express because many believed they would never see him on WWE programming again. We're going to be seeing Jim Cornette on the WWE Network on March 31st. That much has been confirmed. But Cornette recently revealed on his podcast that the invite made him angry because WWE proved him wrong. And this is words from him. I made the big news this week. I trended on the gimmick. I was retweeted numerous times. Everything was very positive. Some people were like, oh, well, you said you'd never do this. No, actually, I didn't. I had to admit, actually, it's kind of pissing me off, this whole thing. Because I've never admitted I was wrong so many times in the course of, like, a fucking 3-month period. I didn't think they would put the Rock and Roll in, and they did. I really didn't think that they would ask me to do it, and they did. Then I guess I couldn't really go back on another of my words and have to be one again and say that I would do if they asked. And to try to be the kindler and gentler Cornette that I've become in my old age. I must admit, it was a very cordial conversation. The next full episode of Jim Cornette's Experiences is set to be released on Thursday, and you can check out a preview below. But yeah, it's definitely interesting that Jim Cornette's going to be making an appearance on WWE. You know, he definitely has a, you know, very interesting way of speaking sometimes, because he will go right off the cuff, and he's going to be showing at the WWE Hall of Fame, where you could say whatever you want, but I definitely think he's going to be nice. He's there to induct someone. I don't think he's going to be putting himself over or anything. So that's pretty interesting. But now we have some other huge news. And this article is called WWE Reportedly Trying to Buy ROH. This is interesting. Well, this is something we should have seen coming a long time ago, but it's shocking news nonetheless. After all, WWE has turned themselves into who they are by getting rid of any competition they had in their way. WWE brought up every big star during the territory days and later bought out as many regional promotions as possible. They have acquired every tape library they have been able to get their hands on and have made the WWE Network consist of just about every televised professional wrestling match ever. Now it looks like the WWE is moving even closer to a deal which would buy Ring of Honor from Sinclair Broadcasting. Pro Wrestling Sheet reports these negotiations between WWE and ROH have been ongoing since at least January and have been slowly progressing, with the plan being a full takeover if the deal is made official. So continuing. If the company were to acquire ROH, it would absorb arguably NXT's biggest competition in regards to being the top spot for big independent names to go and apply their craft. But don't fret if you are thinking ROH will be gone forever, because the plan would include airing ROH weekly show on the WWE Network. Therefore, the plan is most likely to keep the company together to a certain extent. The report notes this is an ongoing situation and there's no actual deal on the table just yet. A lot of things can go on when you're talking about a large acquisition like this. But apparently, ground is being made on the deal. So that's interesting. You know, the fact that WWE could be possibly buying ROH. Like I said, ROH is probably one of the biggest indie companies in the world. It's probably, you know, NXT, you could consider it too, but it's part of WWE, so I don't really consider it. It's probably like ROH, and then it will probably be New Japan Pro Wrestling, and then it will probably be like Lucha Underground or something like that. But both are really big indie companies. And ROH, you know, it pretty much, if that gets bought out, that kills one of NXT's competitions. So I'm pretty interested in seeing what happens with this. It will be kind of sad to see ROH go, because a lot of people have worked there, people have watched it for so long. And it's been on since 2002, so, you know, it's going to be interesting to see if ROH does or doesn't go, so let's wait and see. Then, the next article is called Bray Wyatt Wants to Form an Alliance with Bo Dallas. While speaking to Justin Barrazzo of Sports Illustrated, Bray Wyatt talked about his brother Bo Dallas and mentioned that he is the most underrated WWE superstar of all time. He also mentioned that he would like to form an alliance with him at some point. And this is his words. Bo Dallas is quite possibly the most talented wrestler on either roster, said Wyatt. He is the most underrated wrestler of all time, in my opinion. He has so much to give. At some point, I would love to form an alliance with him, because I know who and what he really is. Whether people want to look at him like that, well, then I'll show you it's very, very possible. Wyatt also spoke if there are plans for the Wyatt family to reunite to conquer the threat of Randy Orton. There was a lot of damage and many burnt bridges right now, admitted Wyatt. The Wyatt family will always exist in one form of fashion, whether or not the four or us are back ever back together again. It's not the thing to look at us on television, but when you're standing next to us to all of us together. It's almost too dominant of a presence. You can't hack away at us. We're four giants. As much as I would like to be reunited with my brothers, I don't really need them right now, but it's always a possibility. You can check out the full interview here. I'm not going to read the full interview, so... So yeah, I guess that'd be interesting to see if Bray Wyatt and Bo Dallas formed an alliance together, since they are brothers in real life, so that's pretty interesting right there. I personally don't really care for Bo Dallas all that much. I think he's alright, but I don't care for him all that much, so we're going to have to wait and see what happens. Then the next article is a sad title. Jim Ross's wife, Jane, has passed away, and this was written on March 23rd, 2017. Jim Ross recently noted on his blog that he was on life support, and now unfortunately he has confirmed that she has passed away. Ross took to Twitter to notify the world that Jane has passed away, and this is a heartbreaking news indeed. And this is Jim Ross. On March 22nd, 2017 at 8:40 p.m., a priest gave my wife, Jane, her last rites today. My little angel is gone. And you can find his Twitter account by writing at JR's Barbecue. So then it continues by saying, earlier this week it was reported that Jim Ross's wife had unfortunately been involved in a car accident. Jane was riding her Vespa scooter home from the gym when she was hit from behind by a teenager driving a car. The accident left her injured, and with several skull fractures, she was taken to a hospital where she later had received surgery, and she remained in critical condition until she passed. This is a pretty sad situation. I feel bad for Jim Ross. It's a sad situation for his wife, and I hope her family and her friends can get through this, and I hope Jim Ross can get through this, but it's a really sad situation. Then it continues to say that Jim Ross is beloved by his friends and peers, as well as wrestling fans around the world. As soon as he broke the news, the wrestling world responded with nothing but love and support, and you can see some of these reactions below. So I'm going to read some of them. So this is his response to his tweet. Lance Storm wrote it on the same day at 8:44, and you can find his Twitter account handle by writing at Lance Storm. So sorry for your loss. Eric Bischoff wrote at 9:08, and you can find his Twitter handle by saying by writing at E Bischoff. My heart hurts for you right now. I am so sorry for your loss and can't imagine the pain. Rest in peace, Jane. Ariel Helenway, you could find her one by writing at Ariel Helenwana. So sorry to hear this, Jim. My heart goes out to you and your family. Roderick Strawn, and you can find his Twitter handle by writing at Roderick Strawn, says, I'm so sorry for your loss. He wrote this at 9:03, and Errol Will Hill is at 8:45. Peyton Royce wrote at 9:01, and you can find her Twitter account by looking at WWE Peyton Royce. I'm so sorry for your loss. Thoughts with you and your loved ones. Alexa Bliss wrote at 9:23 p.m. On the same day, and you can find her account by looking up at Alexa at Bliss WWE. So sorry for your loss. Renee Young wrote, and you can find her Twitter handle is at Renee Young WWE, and she wrote this at 9:30. I'm so sorry to hear this. So much love sent to you and your family. And she was the last one off this list, but there's probably a lot more. We like to offer our sincerest condolences to Jim Ross and his family during this tough time. Let's all try to remember to keep him in our thoughts, as Jim Ross has truly given us so much over the course of his career. A little support is the least we can give him right now. And, you know, I think that just says it all right there. So it's a sad situation, sad for Jim Ross, and I hope he gets through this okay. Then the next article is called Sami Zayn comment on his lack on the main on his lack of success on the main roster, because this is a topic I talk about a lot on this channel, and it's a topic that gets talked about a lot. And this article was created on March 23rd, 2017, so I'm just going to talk about it now. During Sami Zayn's run with NXT, he was one of the brand's top stars, and he even captured the NXT Championship for a short while. Fans were thrilled to see Sami Zayn join the WWE main roster when he got caught up, but Zayn's hasn't been nearly as successful on NXT as he was on Raw as he was in NXT. The former NXT champion recently spoke to the Wig about his lack of main roster success, and he has faith that he's getting close to reaching the next level. So this is Sami Zayn's words. I see sometimes the fans make a much bigger deal of these losses than I personally do, but you can't win them all. You just can't, he said. You do your best and that's it. You lose a few here or there. You've just got to be good at forgetting those losses or using them as motivation to drive yourself forward. It doesn't really stop my momentum. I think I'm in a good place right now, and I feel like I'm just on the cusp of doing something really good or really breaking out to that next level. I feel I'm just outside the bubble, testing myself against guys like Braun Strowman or Samoa Joe are really what I think is going to make me to the next level. Well, I'm really going to take me to the next level. I don't look at these losses in any way as a defeat. I use them as a motivation, if anything, or I just move forward. I can see what he's saying there. I'm hoping that's the case. But, you know, I could see that this is him, because they kind of don't really feature him like he is kind of going forward. They feature him like they don't like him. Because sometimes Stephanie McMahon, which it sounds like with Vince McMahon, I don't think they really see a lot of potential in Sami Zayn. I think they just see somebody that they can just grasp all the money out of. So this is kind of what I think. So then this is the next part of the article, though. As of right now, it doesn't look like WWE officials have any big plans for Sami Zayn at WrestleMania. However, main event in WrestleMania is one of his big goals, and Zayn says he would like to face Kevin Owens at the big event someday. If I could main event at WrestleMania with Kevin Owens one day, wow, that would be pretty much as a big as it could get, considering we're two guys that started wrestling each other in front of 40 people 15 years ago, he said. From a sentimental standpoint, the journey coming full circle kind of way, I'd have to say Kevin Owens. I think there'd be a crazy level of electricity in the air. Then it asks, if Sami Zayn ever gets the chance to main event WrestleMania, who would you like to see him face? Sound off in the comments below. But Kevin Owens would be a great option. And, you know, this is the year they could have done it. Kevin Owens was the WWE Universal Champion. You could have had Sami Zayn win the Rumble, and then, you know, there's always storyline. Or you could have had Sami Zayn earn a shot to get the title and have Sami Zayn walk out WWE Universal Champion. But that didn't happen. But if other people, I'd like to see him wrestle maybe like Roman Reigns, like as Reigns as a heel, Zayn as a face, and Reigns putting down Sami Zayn, saying he's just a little guy. That'd be interesting. Seth Rollins, but I don't know if that's a main event WrestleMania category type match. AJ Styles really isn't. John Cena, that is kind of an odd main event match, but you could find there is people he could main event WrestleMania with, so we'd have to wait and see. But those would be some that I would throw out there. Maybe Finn Balor. That's a match they haven't really done yet. And then only four more. Why Hulk Hogan isn't coming back to WWE just yet? There was a lot of talk about bringing back Hulk Hogan. There was a lot of talk about bringing Hulk Hogan back into the WWE's fold soon. Some speculated fans would even be seeing him at WrestleMania. which I wanted to see him back at WrestleMania. You know, that's where Hulkamania came from. You know, Hulk Hogan belongs at WrestleMania, and he should have been fired in the first place. But due to recent events, it appears as though Hulk Hogan won't be coming back to WWE as quickly as some might have believed or hoped. Cage Side Seats reports there was a rumor circulating saying Hulk Hogan might not be back as soon as possible, as soon as people would have liked because of the recent Page scandal. Both stars were victims of cyber attacks and had their private media release to the general public. However, Hulkster's case is quite different because he won a multi-million dollar lawsuit due to the matter. But then again, Page also wasn't caught on tape using racial slurs, so it all comes out in the wash. Both of these people were victims, though let's never forget that fact. So it would be kind of sad if Hulk Hogan wasn't at WrestleMania, but then it continues by saying, but I guess I'd understand it, you know, I wouldn't be disappointed because it's like, you know, they've already fired him, so it's like, we already knew Hulk Hogan has no plans to be at WrestleMania. He will be in Orlando, but he's opening a beach shop that week, and he has advertised to be there all weekend, signing autographs and snapping selfies with fans. This Hogan's beach shop is something he's been planning for a while now, too. It's not something that just sprung up because of Mania in Orlando, either. But if there was any doubt as to if WWE might still try to bring him in for the show of shows, this probably answers those questions. WWE doesn't want to pull Hulk Hogan in for WrestleMania as planned because they don't want to draw any attention toward either his or Paige's situation. Feeling the similarities in the two stories is a very real thing about Titan Towers. Therefore, they're playing it very safe. But as they say in WWE, anything is possible. So don't be surprised if we hear this icon, if we hear his iconic music break out sometime on April 2nd. Although it's highly unlikely, I'm still gonna remain hopeful. But it could happen. I hope it happens, and we'll have to see if it happens. So, that would be pretty interesting. But if Hogan doesn't come out, I won't be disappointed with it. But I would like to see Hogan back. I heard they are on talks of putting him back. Triple H has been talking to him and stuff, so we're going to have to wait and see if Hulk Hogan does come back to WWE. Because I remember when this scandal broke out a couple of years ago, I remember being pissed about it because Hulk Hogan should have been fired from WWE. So, yeah. Then we have the next article. It's called Stephanie McMahon fought for a John Cena heel turn at one point. This is interesting. You wouldn't think Stephanie McMahon would fight for something like this. So let's continue. John Cena is the ultimate good guy. He's been the face of the WWE for 12 years now, and kids around the world look up to him and respect him as a role model. However, John Cena's Goody Two Shoes act has become stale for quite a few wrestling fans around the world, and many have been calling for him to turn heel for years. One person who wanted John Cena to turn heel at one time is WWE's chief brand officer, Stephanie McMahon. Stephanie officially appeared on the Cheap Seat podcast, and she told Peter Rosenberg that although she wanted to see it happen, she glad it didn't. But it's pretty interesting that Stephanie McMahon had fought for John Cena heel turn. And this is her words. At one point in his career, I really wanted to see him turn heel. I wanted it as a fan, and I also thought it was the right thing to do, but it turns out I was wrong. Peter Rosenberg asked her if she went as far as to fight for the turn, and she confirmed that she did, but she also confirmed that she's over the idea. Oh yeah, totally I did, yeah. But I'm glad we didn't go that way. I think it would be odd for John to turn heel. I guess never say never because anything can happen in WWE, but I don't think I would really miss it. I think that we would miss him. I don't know that we would miss the heel turn. And then it's everyone out there seems to have their own idea as to how a John Cena heel turn should happen if WWE decides to pull the trigger. Hopefully someday Stephanie McMahon will reveal the specifics of the idea that she pitched. Do you still think John Cena should turn heel? How would you turn him heel if you were in charge? Sound off in the comments below. So, I kind of wish Stephanie McMahon had fought for it, but I don't know what the storyline she had was written for it, so that would be kind of scary. But I wonder what would have happened if they had pulled the trigger. And they can't say, well, it would be weird if Cena turned heel. People thought it was going to be weird when Hulk Hogan turned heel, and when he turned heel, that was great. When Rocky Maivia turned heel as The Rock, that was great, and even when he went to Hollywood. So if I was to book a John Cena heel turn, I'll just give you some things. I would have done it at the Royal Rumble. Have John Cena win in a heel way against AJ Styles, and have John Cena be like the movie star heel, just like The Rock was, and have him go against AJ Styles. You know, AJ Styles is someone that's really loved in the business. But if I could book it, you know, that's more of a modern one. But if I could book it another way, is I would, you know, at WrestleMania 30, have John Cena face The Undertaker for a streak. And have John Cena beat The Undertaker at WrestleMania by cheating, ending the streak, turning him heel, and then you can make then everybody would hate him because he did the one thing that everybody would have hated, and that's break The Undertaker's undefeated streak at WrestleMania. Those would be kind of some ideas that I have. All right, then continuing, we have the next article is called Goldberg Talks About Busted Himself Open While Headbutting That Door. I figured this would be kind of something funny to talk about. On the debut episode of ENC Pod of Awesomeness, Edge and Christian hold Goldberg as their guest. Goldberg shared his personal experience of headbutting the door that night on Raw when he busted himself open before his promo even started. So you guys know me, dude. I go from 0 to 100, Goldberg said to Edge and Christian. How about when I knocked myself out on the door? You didn't hear that one? I did that a month ago. Christian said, we all have our different ways of getting ready. Goldberg laughed and continued. Well, yeah, my way of getting ready, you know me, man. They knock on my door. I pour a bottle of water on my head so I don't catch on fire from the sparks. And I headbutt the door. I'm a Neanderthal. That's what I do. So fast forward now, I'm a little bit seasoned and things are not the same, but I'm trying to remember my sequence. So I headbutt the door and all of a sudden, you know, I pull that door open and man, it's like I don't know what's going on and I was a little dizzy. I'm walking to the wind and I go through gorilla position and then I get in the ring. Man, I literally forgot every single thing I was supposed to say, and the cameraman throws me a towel and I'm like, what is this towel for? I know I sweat a lot, but I got blood dripping down my forehead from the door and I had no idea, man. I don't do this stuff to be written about. I do it because I gotta do certain things to be me. There is a possessed man, and I told Mr. McMahon afterwards, and I said, fault me for trying too hard and not trying hard enough, you know. If you use any of these quotes from this article, please credit ENC's Pot of Awesomeness with a HT to still real to us for the transcription. So I think that qualifies. But yeah, so it's interesting. Yeah, that's a pretty funny story right there. And I remember seeing that episode of Raw. It was pretty funny. And then we have the last article. Shawn Michaels says he turned down a match against AJ Styles at WrestleMania this year, because that match was rumored to happen. AJ Styles turned heads back in October when he told SI.com that he wanted Shawn Michaels to come out of retirement and face him at the Royal Rumble. It seemed a little ridiculous that HBK would come back to the ring at age 51 after 7 years in retirement, but it apparently wasn't crazy enough for WWE to rule out having him return at WrestleMania this year. Michaels revealed on the latest episode of the Sam Roberts Wrestling Podcast that he was offered the opportunity to face Styles at WrestleMania 33 in Orlando. I guess I'm breaking something with you. I don't even know if I should. But I could have had that match, Michael said. They didn't have an opponent for AJ at WrestleMania. I said that I hadn't been asked because I hadn't, but then I was. I said, I wish that young man was here 10 years ago, man. I honestly do. I think he's very talented. Shawn Michaels goes behind the scenes of the Click and looks ahead to WrestleMania. Of course, it's tough to break through the kayfabe in a situation like this. Did WWE really ask Shawn Michaels to come out of retirement, or is he hyping up WrestleMania and Styles' match with Shane McMahon? So it's pretty interesting because that was a match that was rumored to happen at the Royal Rumble, was AJ Styles versus Shawn Michaels for the WWE Championship. So was it meant to happen? Was it going to happen? Who knows? I think it was a good idea because Shawn Michaels, I would like to stay retired because I would like him to be one of those wrestlers that actually keeps the words for a change and stays retired, doesn't come back. But if he came back, I wouldn't complain. If he had a match with AJ Styles, I would love that match. But I feel like his last match would be with Taker at WrestleMania 26. So, yeah. But that's what's going on in the world of wrestling. A lot of interesting stuff. The stuff I'm pretty interested about is WWE buying ROH. Hardy Boys possibly coming back to WWE. I'm not really interested in it, but I'm keeping my eyes on it. But Moa and Alo stuff, Jim Ross's stuff. So, definitely some interesting stuff. But thank you guys for watching this video. I talked for a long-ass time. I didn't think I was actually going to end up talking this long, but whatever. Make sure to subscribe to this channel and my other channels for more content. That's pretty much it, guys. Talk to you later. Oops, sorry. Talk to you later.